Hey everybody, it's Mr. N here, and we are going to do this lesson on curve sketching. Basically, this lesson is just being able to find all the things we have talked about in the previous sections, whereas can you take a function, determine where the zeros are, determine where the critical points are, determine where the intervals of increasing, decreasing, intervals of concavity, inflection points, everything that we've done, and put it all together into one, and then be able to sketch the curve of it. So that's where you end up at the last part of it. So first of all, here are some guidelines. It's always good to find the domain first so you know what possible x values you can use. Then find any intercepts. When I say find any intercepts, we can set the y equal to 0 and solve it. And then determine if there's any symmetry. That would help. So then you can graph part of it. You know what the other part will look like. If it's an even function, it'll be symmetric about the y-axis. If it's an odd function, it will be symmetric about the origin. So you can think of it as it's rotated. Okay, so odd would be x to the third, x to the fifth, etc. Think of this, and I rotated it around to end up with that. And then if it's periodic, which you will have a lot of times with trig functions. And then determine if there's any asymptotes, horizontal, vertical. And you can do slant asymptotes. However, on the AP test, they're not going to ask you anything about slant asymptotes. So we're going to skip this one right now just to make things a little bit easier on ourselves. Then determine intervals of increasing, decreasing. Find local maximum minimums and intervals of concavity and inflection points with all the techniques that we have done. So you can go back into the previous videos and the previous sections and see how we've determined all those. Okay, and then we're going to sketch it. A lot of times when I do those examples, you'll see me kind of combine all this stuff into one because it's easier just to take the two derivatives right off the bat and then do it that way. All right, so let's take a look at what we have for our first example here. We've got do steps 1 through 8 and sketch the curve from our notes of this function, x squared plus 3 over x minus 1. So for this one here, we can see that the domain, if I write these as the steps that we have that I wrote down before, we can see that the domain, this was step one, the domain is going to be all real numbers except x being 1, right? So that we will have something going on at 1. It doesn't look like it's going to be a whole. Most likely it will be an asymptote at this point. But we'll determine that in a little bit. So step 2, well, let's find out what the x-intercept is and the y-intercept. For the x-intercept, I have to say x squared plus 3 equals 0. And in this case, it's going to be imaginary, and I'm not going to worry about it, right? Because I'll have to take the square root of negative 3. All right, and then the y-intercept, for the y-intercept, what we do is we're just going to plug in zeros for the x, right? For the x-intercept, we set it equal to 0. That's why on the x-intercept, I was only worried about the top, because if I set x squared plus 3 over x minus 1 equals 0, cross-multiply, that goes away. All right, so but for the y-intercept, I actually plug 0 in. So this is basically f of 0, where it's going to cross at that point, and I will get 0 plus 3 over 0 minus 1, which is negative 3. So y equals negative 3 is my y-intercept. So I've magically put an axis here right now, and I'm going to go ahead and start plotting points. Typically, I might wait till the end to do this, but in this example, in these examples today, I'm going to go ahead and just start plotting points as I find them. So there is no x-intercept because it's imaginary. The y-intercept is at negative 3, so 1, 2, 3. I'm going to plot, I will plot a point right down here. 1, 2, negative 3, so I know it's going to cross right there. Okay, so that's just kind of giving me some info that I may need. All right, as for symmetry, so step 3, I'll put it right here, step 3. There's no symmetry in this, no symmetry. Because if I plug in negative x, I will get f of negative x. It does not equal f of x. And then also f of negative x does not equal f, or negative, I should say like that, f of x. So this is not even, and this would be not odd. All right, as for the limits, the horizontal asymptotes, I can take a look at this, and I'm going to use the methods that I've taught you before, not the trig methods, but I'm going to use the algebra 2 methods. So I take a look at this, take a look at the highest power on top. The highest power on top is greater than the highest power on the bottom. So there is no limit at infinity in this case. So the limit is infinite. So there is limit is infinite. So there is no horizontal asymptote. So I'm using the techniques. You can check back in the previous videos on how I found the asymptotes, but that's the technique I'm using here for the horizontal asymptotes. For the vertical asymptotes, what I do is set the bottom equal to 0. So for the vertical asymptote, x minus 1 equals 0, x equals 1. This is my vertical asymptote right there. So then I know that at x equals 1, I will have some sort of vertical asymptote, and I can go ahead and put that in there right now, like that, to give me kind of an idea of what's going on. All right, moving on to step 6. Now I'm going to combine, this was step 4 right here, vertical and horizontal asymptotes. I forgot I put it as step 4 in your notes. Okay, so I'm not going to worry about slant asymptotes, oblique ones, because we said we're not going to do that. But if you were to do that with the technique, going back to what you learned in trig, you would divide this out, right? You would say x minus 1 divided by, here, I'll write it here, for oblique. You would say the x minus 1 divided by this x squared plus 0x plus 3. And you would find out that y, over here would be x plus 1, so y equals x plus 1 would be an oblique asymptote if I wanted to do that. Again, that is not on the AP test, but since I went ahead and did it already for you, let's go ahead and put that in. So you do have this kind of oblique asymptote that goes like this. Okay, so down one over one right there, like this. But I'm not going to worry about that too much right now. I'm more concerned with the other things. Okay, so now I'm going to combine steps 5, 6, and 7 kind of like into one. 5 through 7, we'll say. And I want to find derivatives here. So I'm going to find f prime of x. Setting f prime of x equal to 0 will give me critical points. I'll test my critical points on the number line method to determine intervals of concavity. While I'm at it, I'm going to take a second derivative. And the second derivative, right, will give me my concavity. And the critical points will give me my increasing and decreasing. I should have said it correctly. All right, so let's find f prime of x. F prime of x is going to be over here, the bottom, times derivative of the top, which will be 2x, minus the top, which is x squared plus 3, times derivative of the bottom, which is 1, all over the x minus 1 squared, the bottom squared. All right, so now I'm going to go ahead and clean this up a little bit. So let's see what I can do. I can, over here, I can FOIL this out. And I'm going to save you a little bit of a hassle. I have it written down in front of me here. I cleaned this up. I distributed and cleaned up. I end up with x squared minus 2x minus 3 all over x minus 1 squared. Okay? So that's my first derivative. Let's go ahead at this point and take a second derivative, f double prime of x. And I will get, again, the bottom times the derivative of the top minus the top times the derivative of the bottom squared. I'm going to give you the final version of this just to save some time in the video so you don't see me doing all those things. Again, it's the bottom, x minus 1 squared times the derivative of the top. In this case, it'll be 2x minus 2, right, etc. Plus the top times the derivative, or minus the bottom times the derivative of the top minus the top times the derivative of the bottom over the bottom squared. I can say it. And then when it cleans up, that's what you end up with, okay? So for the critical points, we're going to take this derivative, x squared minus 2x minus 3 all over this x minus 1 squared, and we're going to set this equal to 0. So I end up with the bottom canceling out, and then I'll end up with x squared minus 2x minus 3 equals 0. And this factors, believe it or not, into x plus 1 x minus 3 equals 0. So my critical points are at x equals negative 1 and 3. But don't forget, critical points are also where f of x is undefined, right? Or f of prime of x is undefined. So we want f prime of x equaling 0 or undefined. It'll be undefined when I take a look at f prime of x at x equals 1. So I need to add that into my list of critical points. So I'm going to test these critical points now on a number line. Negative 1, 1, and 3. And I'll put the intervals in between to determine what happens. Okay, so this is my f prime of x, and I'm testing it on this number line. Let's move this up a little bit. See if we can slide it all up. Okay, and then I'm going to test all these intervals on here. So over here in this interval, I get... if I put in to my f prime equation, if I put in like negative 10, right, I'll get positive values, and I'm putting it into my f prime equation right there. When I put something between negative 1 and 1, such as 0, I will get negative values. When I put in some number between 1 and 3, such as 2, I will get negative values again. So on here, when you put in 2, you will get negatives. And then 3, you will get positives greater than 3. So if I put in like 10, okay? So that's my intervals right there. And so now I can say the intervals of increasing are going to be from negative infinity to negative 1 and 3 to infinity. Decreasing is going to be from negative 1 to 1, union 1 to 3. Notice I couldn't include this point 1, right? So I had to break it up like that, because at 1, it's neither increasing nor decreasing. Okay, so now let's determine intervals of concavity and any possible inflection points. So I know where it's increasing. I know where it's decreasing. Let's determine f double prime of x. So here's my f double prime of x. I need to take the second derivative and... set it equal to 0, the or undefined again, and this gives me my possible inflection points, okay? So let's see what happens here. When I do this, I will get, well, setting it equal to 0, nothing happens. So I'll just get x equals 1, and I need to test x equals 1 on a second derivative, right? When I put in something greater than 1, right into this equation right there, I will get positive values. When I put in something less than that, I will get negative values. So, for example, if I put in negative 10, I'd get negative 11 cubed. I'd get a negative number, right? So that's where I got that negative. All right, so now I know that it's concave up, and I know that there is a point of inflection. There's a point of inflection at x equals 1 because it changes from negative to positive, and it's concave up on the interval from 1 to infinity and down on the interval from negative infinity to 1. Going back to here, I forgot to write down where I have a relative maximum and minimum. I forgot to put those for you guys. Okay, over here, the slopes go positive, change to negative. I have a relative maximum at x equals negative 1. And then over here, nothing happens in this region, I should say, right in here. But when I get back to this region over here, I go from negative to positive. So I end up with a relative minimum at x equals 3. All right, so now let's determine how we're going to sketch all this. I have a relative maximum at negative 1 right here in the x. And if I put in negative 1 into my f of x equation, so this will give me my relative negative 1, comma, and I will get negative 2. Okay, so this is my relative maximum. So negative 1, 2, right there like that. Okay, and I have a relative minimum, I said, at when I put in 3, I will get a value of 6 when I put it into my original f of x equation. So 3, 6, and I'm going to slide this down again. Oops, slide this whole thing down. It's not letting me do it in one big swoop here, so we'll have to do it like that. Okay, that's perfect. All right, so we want to plot the point 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Double checking that. There's my relative minimum. So here what happens is I end up with concave up from 1 to infinity. So all of this, anything from open interval 1 to infinity, this is going to be concave up. And that's my relative right here. That's going to be a relative minimum. So it continues to follow the asymptote this way. On this side, it'll look like this. That's my maximum. It'll follow the asymptote that way. Okay, and if you can take a look here, you'll see that the intervals of increasing, decreasing, I am decreasing from negative 1 to 3 with nothing happening at 1 because that's asymptote. So look, from negative 1 to 3, I'm going down. From negative 1, from positive 1 to 3 here, I'm going down again. Then I'm increasing, and over here, anything on this end, I'm increasing up to that point where I hit the maximum. So that is that sketch. And that's how we did all this work. So let's see if we can do another one. All right, this one is very similar. So let's try to do our steps on this one and see where we end up. I'm going to go ahead and I will put in the grid here again. This time I got a little smarter. I'm going to put a little bit lower so that as I scroll up, I can do it. Sometimes I get a little smarter like that. Sometimes I don't. Okay, so let's determine the domain and range on this one. So first of all, the domain here, step one, the domain is going to be all reals again, except x equals 2, right? And you can determine the x-intercepts and the y-intercepts for step two. The x-intercept is going to be, I'm going to go ahead and set x equal to, or set the equation equal to 0. So x squared over x squared minus 4 equals 0. So the x-intercept is at 0. The y-intercept, I'm going to plug 0 into the equation. 0 squared over 0 squared minus 4 gives me 0 again. Okay, so the x and y-intercepts are at 0. So this crosses at 0, 0 over here. We know that. We can go ahead and plot that point. All right, so now let's find out if there's anything else we know. I just realized this is kind of, this little grid seems to be a little off kilter there. I don't know if that's any better, but let's see. Nope, still kind of off kilter. I get off on a tangent. Let me fix that. Okay, that looks a little bit better. So now let's take a look at what else we have here. We got the x-intercept. We got the y-intercept. Let's see if there's any symmetry. So for this one, I'm going to test symmetry. I'm going to say f of negative x, and that equals, when I put in a negative, oh, it's going to equal f of x. So this is symmetric about the y-axis because it's even. That is an even function. So that's good to know. Okay, and let's find out the asymptotes for horizontal asymptotes. Okay, I'm going to take the limit as x goes to infinity, right? But I told you guys, take a look at this. It's easier to do it that way. That's the technique we're going to use, and that's going to be 1. So y equals 1 is a horizontal asymptote. So let's put that in here. At 1, I have this horizontal asymptote. All right, moving on to the next step over here. Let's see. Do I have any vertical asymptotes? Vertical. I'm going to take the bottom. Set that equal to 0. That determines if I have any vertical asymptotes. At this point, I'm going to get x equals plus or minus 2. So I have vertical asymptotes at x equals plus or minus 2. So at 1, 2, I'm going to do this. Do, 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 do. And at negative 2, I've got another one like that. Kind of sketching that in for you guys. All right, so those are my vertical asymptotes. Let's take a look at what we got next for step 5. Let's go ahead and do the derivatives at this point. So the derivative of this is, like I said, 5 through 7. Actually, I typically do 5 through 7, and step 8 is the graphing one. All right, so over here, f prime of x is going to be the bottom times the derivative of the top, oops, which will be 2x. 2x, let's make that look better. Okay, 2x, bottom times the derivative of the top, minus the top, times the derivative of the bottom, which is 2x again, all over this bottom squared, and I've cleaned this up on the side here for you guys, and this ends up being negative 8x over x squared minus 4 squared. All right, let's see what we got next. Let's move. Here we go again. It's not wanting to move on for me. Let's find out what the second derivative is while we're at it. F double prime of x will give me bottom times the derivative of the top. So this will be x squared minus 4 squared times the derivative of the top, which is negative 8, minus the top, negative 8x, times the derivative of the bottom, which would give me 2, x squared minus 4 to the first times 2x over this bottom squared. Squared, which gives me to the fourth power. All right, cleaning all this up, I'm just going to save you that hassle and tell you that this comes out to be 24x squared plus 32 all over x squared minus 4 to the, it ends up being third power here. So I'm going to take my first derivative and set that equal to 0. So negative, so f prime of x equals negative 8x over x squared minus 4. I'm going to take this squared equals 0 to get my critical points. Or undefined, right? Or undefined. So my critical points come out to be x equals 0 and then plus or minus 2. So on this case, how'd I get plus or minus 2? Because that's one undefined over here. How'd I get 0? Cross multiply, you get negative 8x equals 0. X is 0. Okay, take the second derivative. Set that equal to 0. This gives me my possible inflection points, and I need to look to see if they are in intervals of concavity. So I'm going to take this, or undefined, I should say, right? And we know the undefined one, again, will be plus or minus 2. That's easy. Now take the top, set it equal to 0. I'll have imaginary numbers. So the top, nothing happens. That's the only spots I need to be concerned with my inflection points. All right, so now let's move it all up again. And I'm going to put these on a number line to test out some stuff and see what happens. I'm putting, this is my f prime and my f double prime. I'm going to put them right next to each other this time. My f prime, negative 2, 0, and 2. My f double prime, negative 2, and positive 2. Those are the only things I need to test. So let's start testing some points in these regions. Okay, so for f prime, when I test negative 3 over here, I'm going to get negative 4, negative 3, negative whatever. I'm going to get positive values when I'm testing this region. Okay, then I'm going to test this region. I'm going to test all these regions. The next region over here, I'm going to put in like negative 1, and I'll get positive values again. And where am I putting it in? I'm putting it into this f prime graph. So if you put in negative 1 here, right, you'll get a positive, negative 1 here, you'll get this became negative, squared is a positive. So positive over positive gave me that positive. So I'm just saving you the time and hassle and doing it for you. When you put in 1, you will get a negative in this region right here. And then when you put in something greater than 2, such as 10, you're also going to get negative values. Okay, so all negatives in this in these two regions. So that's what this one looks like. Let's test the concavity. Over here, well, we can, let's look at this. Do we have any relative maximums or minimums over here? I could tell right here I change from a positive slope to a negative slope. Positive to negative. I have a relative maximum. We'll write it right here. Relative maximum at x equals 0. Okay, so I just wrote it right there for you guys instead, a little bit easier. Let's take a look at the next thing over here. That's the only spot where I see any max mins. Over here, let's test these regions. I'm going to test again in f double prime. I'm going to test this region, and that region. So let's see what happens. I pick a number greater than or less than negative 2, so negative 10. Right, I put it in my second derivative equation. In my second derivative equation, I'm looking over here. right there. And I will, if I put in something like negative 10, I'll get a positive on top, positive on the bottom. Everything ends up being positives. Now pick a value between negative 2 and 2, such as 0. I will get on top a positive. I'll get on the bottom a negative. This gives me a negative. And then here I'll get positives when I test a region there. So this tells me that I have a this tells me that this changes from concave up right here to concave down. So this is an IP at negative 2 and 2. But wait a minute. I can't have an inflection point at negative 2 and 2 because look what I have. I've got asymptotes right there. There is no point there, right? So I got to throw those out. So the asymptote trumps that inflection point. Even though we know it's changing concavity there, there is no inflection point because the asymptote, there's nothing, there is no point there. There's an asymptote, and it's not going to cross it in this situation because that's a vertical asymptote. So how can I do all this? Well, take a look. I know that it reaches a maximum value here, and I know that it's concave down in this whole region. Right? It's in this whole region. Then I've got increasing and decreasing. So concave down, increasing, decreasing means this is increasing like that and concave down. This is decreasing, concave down. That's what that's going to look like there in that region. Then I've got other regions. I've got no other y-intercepts or x-intercepts, but I have these regions that I got to worry about. And in this region, it's concave up and increasing. So it's increasing because f prime is positive, and concave up. So increasing concave up, and I know where my asymptotes are, so that means it's going to look like this in that whole region. Increasing concave up. And over here on the other side of it, on the flip side of it, I am decreasing in this whole region and concave up. Wait a minute, decreasing concave up, that means it's decreasing, but then the concavity is still up, so it'll look like that, and the concavity never changes. So that is what this particular function graph would look like. The asymptotes helped me, the asymptote trumped any of those inflection points I may have found, so I had to throw those out because they were asymptotes there. All right, let's move on to the next one. So here we have one with a trig function. We've got f of x equals cosine x over 1 plus sine x. So over here, let's do our steps again. Let's do everything we got to do. Let's pick a different color. I'm going to go with green on this one. And let me put my grid here. And let's go ahead and do this. Let's first start with our domain and range. My domain, well, typically I haven't been finding the range because it's all reals on these. We've placed it to be that. Okay, so the domain on this one will be all reals except for the bottom equaling 0. So if I set the bottom equal to 0, I get sine x equals negative 1, right? If I set the bottom equal to 0, sine x equals negative 1. So this will be all reals except x being 3 pi over 2 plus k times 2 pi. Right, remember, so we go for every rotation. When I graph this, I'll probably only graph maybe out to 2 pi. I'm not going to go further than that because this is going to end up being periodic. All right, so step 2, let's see if we can find the x-intercepts and the y-intercepts. So for the x-intercept, I'm going to go ahead and set the equation equal to 0. And I'll end up with the cosine of x equaling 0. So x will be pi over 2 plus that k times 2 pi. Again, every rotation of that. For the y-intercept, I'll put 0 in, cosine 0 over 1 plus sine 0, and I will end up with 1 on this one. So the y-intercept will be at 1. So over here, I will get 1, and I can go ahead and plot that at 0, 1. It's going to cross through right there. And let's see what else we got. In fact, I might make this, if possible, a little bit bigger. All right, so then let's go ahead. We know that this is going to be symmetric, so let's see what the symmetry is going to be. This is going to be periodic. We know this because it is a trig function. All right, so then let's determine any horizontal or vertical asymptotes that we can get out of this. So for the horizontal asymptote, we need the limit as x goes to infinity. And in this one, I really can't use that little technique for the polynomials, but you will end up with something infinite because as cosine gets huge, you're going to get nothing that converges to anything. So this is going to be no horizontal asymptote since it's periodic as well. The top or the bottom won't converge to any particular value. They're just going to flip-flop. Okay, so but we do have vertical asymptotes on this, vertical asymptotes. And you should recognize that a cosine function, sine function, again, you won't end up with a horizontal asymptote at these point in these values. Okay. Basically, if you put in negative, if you put in infinity, you're going to get infinity. If you put in negative infinity, you'll get negative infinity. So it doesn't converge to anything. So for the vertical asymptote, we already know what the domain is. So that's going to help us out because we're going to set the bottom equal to zero. We've already done that. So it's going to be 3 pi over 2 plus k times 2 pi, right? Because we've already done 1 plus sine x equals 0. And that was in the step before. So now let's do the next parts. We're going to go 5 through 7, and I'll do those right here. F prime of x. When I take this derivative, I'll get 1 plus sine x, bottom, times derivative of the top. Derivative of sine x, cosine x is the negative sine x minus the top. Cosine, I'm trying to squeeze this in, times derivative of the bottom. Derivative of the bottom is just going to be cosine x over this bottom squared, 1 plus, I should say, sine x squared. And then if I clean this up, I'm going to save you all the steps in between. What you're going to have to do is you're going to have to distribute. And then, well, you know what? I'll go ahead and show you some of these steps because it's good for you to see. So this is going to be negative sine x minus sine squared x minus, this is cosine squared x, right? Do you recognize that? That's 1. Over 1 plus sine x squared. So you should recognize that if I take out a negative, right? It's 1, so I'll end up with really negative 1, which means, again, I'm just going to take this negative out, right? And I'll end up with a sine x plus sine squared x plus cosine squared x all over this 1 plus the sine x squared. Okay, this is my 1. And then I end up with negative sine x plus 1. And look at the bottom is 1. Is really, if I write it this way, plus 1, right, squared. So one of these goes away. So f prime of x really simplifies down to negative 1 over, this will be 1 plus sine x, right? That's what that simplifies down to. So I can set this equal to 0 or undefined. So set it equal to 0 or undefined. And I get my critical points. And this one is just going to be the bottom. In this case, it'll be 3 pi over 2 plus k times 2 pi. Those are all my critical points. So now I'm going to take the second derivative, and I will rewrite this, because it's easier if I just rewrite this as 1 plus sine x to the negative 1 like that. It works out a little bit easier for me when I take that second derivative. After I rewrite it, this is going to give me negative 1 times negative 1 here will be positive 1. And I'll get 1 plus sine x to the negative 2 times derivative here, which would be cosine x. And this would end up being cosine x over 1 plus sine x squared. So all I did was rewrite it, then take the derivative. It's just easier because then I just use a chain rule and I didn't have to use the quotient rule. So just a little trick there. Okay, set this equal to 0 or undefined. We will get our critical points. Let's see if I can slide this whole thing up. Okay, so set this equal to 0. My possible points of inflection, I should say. So the possible points of inflection on the top will be where the cosine of x is equal to 0, so that's pi over 2 plus k times pi. You can actually do absolute value if you go the other way around, right? All of these, we can go absolute values because we can go in a negative direction. I forgot to say that. So for all of these, I should say plus or minus k times pi, plus or minus k times pi, because you can go in the other direction. Okay, so right again here, plus or minus k times
pi over 2. All right, so we've done that one. And the bottom we've already done. It's the same scenario that we have over there for 3 pi over 2. But 3 pi over 2 is the spot where it does not exist. So 3 pi over 2 and 3 pi over 2 plus or minus k times 2 pi. So these are all the things I have to test on a number line. So I will make my number line for f prime, and I will make my number line for f double prime. I will put in the points. Now, I'm not going to do everything over here. What I'm going to choose to do is I'm going to put in certain values, negative pi over 2, and then 3 pi over 2. I'm not going to use all the infinite values I have. I'm just going to test just one basic area, and I'll just graph it from probably negative pi to 2 pi. So that's how I've chosen to do this. And then, so when I test a region in here, I will get between negative pi over 2 and pi over 2, I'll get something that's decreasing when I put it in f prime. And then over here, I will also get a decreasing function. And over here, I'll also get a decreasing function. Believe it or not, it decreases on all values of x. So if I'm putting in a value between negative pi over 2 and pi over 2 in my equation right here for f prime, right? If I put in 0, the sine of 0 is 0, and I'll have negative values. If I put in something in here, I'll get negative values. I end up with negative values wherever I put this. So because 1 minus a sine will never be greater than 1. You can think of it that way, right? If I'm doing this in radians, it'll never be great. So I'll always end up with negative values, which is going to make for an interesting curve. All right, so now let's take a look at the second derivative points that I want to test. And I said, again, pi over 2 plus k times, this time I said pi, which in this case would give me this negative pi over 2 over here that I need to be concerned with. Then I need to be concerned with a pi over 2, and then the 3 pi over 2, right? Because I'm going in every pi this time, because that's when we set that top equal to 0. So what ends up happening here is you end up with something that goes concave up, concave down, concave up, concave down. So this ends up being positive in this region right here, and then from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2, you end up with this ends up being negative here, negative. And then this ends up being positive. And again, I'm just plugging in numbers in here to determine that. So if I plug in, again, 0, I'll get cosine of 0, which is 1 over 1. So that's a positive value. And if I plug something in over here in this region that's larger, I will get negatives. It will be concave down. Then it will be positives. So there's a bunch of inflection points. So inflection point I do know I have at pi over 2. In fact, I'll end up with every inflection point being every one on this interval. It's a little bit hard to grasp that right now with me just saying it real fast. So maybe pause the video and think about that. And yes, you'll see that you will end up with inflection points at those intervals. So now over here at 3 pi over 2, now I could make this into some sort of pi scale. Let's see. There, I could say that this is pi over 2. Do another 2. This is pi. This is 3 pi over 2. I could do this on a trig scale, and this is 2 pi if I did it that way. If I just went in every 2s, I could kind of make this look a little bit better there. All right, so now I know that I'm going to have an asymptote at 3 pi over 2, and then every multiple of that. So then if I and I said right here, every multiple of it with 2 pi. So if I subtract 2 pi from 3 pi over 2, I'll end up with another one over here at negative pi over 2. I have this asymptote like that. Okay, so I end up with those asymptotes there. I know that it crosses, the curve crosses through pi over 2 because I determined that as an intercept and every multiple of that. So it's on the other side as well over here. If you add 3 pi or add 2 pi to it, I went to the wrong spot here. Let's see if I can scroll this without screwing a lot of things up. Okay, right over here where the y-intercept is and the x-intercept, and then I determine my vertical asymptotes. So right here, let me get my pointer tool, the x-intercept pi over 2, so it crossed through pi over 2, and it's going to be every multiple of that. So the next one will be at 2 pi plus pi over 2, which would give me 5 pi over 2, so that's the other spot where it would cross through. But I'm not going to graph all those. I'm only concerned with one of the regions here. Let's just take a look at that. And since this is decreasing with this concavity, and I am told that it changes concavity right here at pi over 2, that's where I determine this. Notice it changes this concavity. I'm going to make my graph reflect that. So now that's concave up like this, and then it'll go concave down like that. So that's what this trail branch looks like. And since I determined up above that it is periodic, it's going to continue this pattern. In fact, it'll cross through here. We said the other spot's going to cross, so this will be concave down like this. It'll be concave up like that. It'll continue this pattern throughout. But I only wanted to graph one little region for you guys because, again, it's periodic and it's just going to repeat itself. So that's the part there. A lot of times when you see these, they will bound them. They'll say, okay, only look at it from negative 2 pi to positive 2 pi and graph that. So it makes the problem a lot easier because then you don't have to deal with these k times 2 pi situations because I know those give you a hard time in trig. All right, so we did 3 examples. That's perfect for now. We'll do a couple more in class. Thanks for watching. Hit that like and subscribe button. I know this was a lot to take in. I know I went pretty fast, so you might have to pause me and rewind me, do what you need to do. But hit that like and subscribe button, and I'll see you guys in the next video.